Hey, welcome back to another episode of Razorback Reels. I'm Adam Roberts.
And I'm Aaron Emsall.
We got a very special show for you tonight. We have a tribute for Paul Newman and, of course, all the reviews for this weekend, so we hope you'll stay with us. Well, as I'm sure you have all already heard, Paul Newman passed away on Friday night at the age of 83.
Yeah, he was a legend in the film industry for sure.
We'll be doing just a brief recap of his career during the second half of the show. But to start things off, we'll review the movies that came out this weekend. Start out with our first review of A Choke by the author of Fight Club.
That mole on your thigh?
Yeah.
You might want to get that looked at. Melanoma is the most common cancer for women, especially blondes.
What's your name?
Victor.
I'm Cherry Dackery. It's not my real name.
We are not born evil sinners or perfect knockoffs of God. The world tells us whether we're heroes or victims, but we can decide for ourselves.
All right, Choke. Now, this movie is about sex addiction. And sex addiction has been in the news recently with David Duchovny and the whole his TV show Californication. So, you know, this movie had to jump right on that bandwagon. But in realistic, this is based on the novel written by the same guy that did Fight Club, Chuck Palahniuk. let's not mention what I just pronounced there. But now this is a great movie. I think this was a really surprise. It's about a guy that has a problem with sex addiction, is in therapy, and he also works as a colonial guide. And it's about a guy that's had with a reenactment of colonial times. And it's about a guy that it has a lot of serious problems based from his childhood. And he's doing all this in order to support his mother, which includes faking choking, which is where the title comes from. He likes to go to restaurants and pretend he's choking in order to get the sympathy and the financial rewards. And what makes this movie really, you know, beyond its quirkiness and beyond its humor is this movie has a lot of heart. This is a movie that really shows a lot of compassion, and it's all about this personal spiritual journey that the main character, that played by Sam Rockwell, who is one of my actually favorite actors, because everything he is in, he is really good in, and this is without a doubt a great role for him. And this movie did have a lot of heart in his search for a spiritual journey.
Right, and that's what surprised me too. When you describe the plot, you know, it's about a sex addict who, you know.
Yeah, you're not thinking.
It sounds like a Dane Cook movie almost.
horrible Dane Cook movie gone wrong.
If he would have, you know, he could have easily taken this role on, and it would have been a completely different movie. And so I really enjoyed Choke a lot. It somehow is able to juxtapose these really sad, heart-wrenching scenes with his flashbacks with his mother to these very hilarious, raunchy comedy scenes. And it does so this is something that's very hard to do. You'll see movies all the time try and have, you know, really sad scenes followed by romantic scenes followed by really funny scenes, like in Ghost Town I talked about last week. It just is almost impossible to pull off. So Choke did a fantastic job, Chuck's book, I suppose. And I would definitely recommend this to anybody over the age of 18, definitely. Yeah. Not one for the kids.
Yeah, it's definitely got its scenes that are not good for kids. But what I really liked is this is a really scumbag character, you know, the main character, Sam Rockwell. And you have no reason to feel sympathy for this character at all. But yet all you do is find yourself feeling sympathy for him throughout the movie. And the guy that plays his best friend, who kind of looks like he's going for like a Seth Rogen look and maybe a Seth Rogen career. But he was really good in it, too. He kind of played a subdued version, which easily could have turned into just a comedic sidekick.
And even the stripper we showed the clip from actually turns out to be a very deep character, and not so in some sort of hokey, contrived way either. I thought it really worked very well on all levels.
Yeah, and Angelica Houston, who played his mother, was also very good in this, and she was very deep. You think it's going to be just kind of this, you know, cranky mom, kind of like Olivia from Sopranos kind of thing, where he's got this mom issues, but then this whole other level opens up throughout the movie, and this movie unravels, you know, just new layers and peels of layers comes from it. And it's just, it really was surprising. And I gave it a B, but really, as I sat here and think about it, I was telling Adam before we went air, this has definitely got to be really a B+. I got to move it up because I really like this movie.
Well, movie that we didn't like so much was Eagle Eye with Shia LaBeouf.
Unfortunately.
All right, Eagle Eye. It's you know, a Shia LaBeouf movie, DJ Caruso, the same guy who directed him in Disturbia. It follows a, you know, it tries to be sort of a smart, maybe political thriller. Turns into just a pretty stupid action movie throughout. He's, as I'm sure you've already know from the trailers, all this terrorist equipment shows up, and he gets this phone call, and he has to follow all these orders from this mysterious person. And it was just a very bad movie. There were some cool action scenes, but it seemed like everything was stolen, like literally shot by shot. Like they literally took the camera and put it in the exact same place as they did for Wanted, as they did for, you know, Live Free or Die Hard. And I don't have any problem at all with people, you know, lifting scenes if they're intended as an homage, but it was just plain stupid. I mean, the whole plot, I know I don't want to spoil anything for you, but pretty much the entire master plan is stolen from Get Smart. And when you take a plot device that was used in a spoof and try to take it seriously, it doesn't work. This whole movie could have been all right if they made it into a comedy, maybe, but you can't. It's put it in a real-world situation, especially where it started out with, and then have all these ridiculous things happen and expect the audience to enjoy it.
I agree, Adam. This movie broke my heart. When I saw the preview for this, I saw it with DJ Caruso, Shia LaBeouf, right, who I like, and I'm an apologist for. I think we both liked him in Indiana Jones, right, and Disturbia.
We had a lot of people disagreed with us on Indiana Jones.
Right.
We offended
but
him.
But we stood up for him. And I like Disturbia, which is the same director, same actor, you know, and I was like, this is going to be a good, you know, action, you know, blockbuster, good movie. Instead, it turns in this generic ripoff. And something with DJ Caruso and Steven Spielberg, because they're ripping off the Alfred Hitchcock themes again. This is like Man Who Knew Too Much. This is like North by Northwest.
Exactly.
I mean, there's a lot of similarities there. Maybe not as much as Disturbia ripped off Rear Window, but right, still, it's like, what is
going
on?
It was even more like 3 Days of the Condor near the beginning. And
yeah.
Right in the middle,
I mean, this
too.
We could rattle off literally a list of like,
yeah,
40 films
we'd be
that
here
this
all night,
ripped off. But
and not in a good way either.
No. I mean, at the beginning, this movie looked like, you know, I was into it. The first 30 minutes, I'm like, all right, you know, backstory. Hopefully they'll follow up this backstory, you know, and this will right, be part of a pertinent part of the film. But no, they
and
don't.
And just one, before we move on, I just want to say something about the really atrocious product placement. I'm completely in favor of product placement movies and TV shows, because that means less commercials that we have to sit through. But when you have the mysterious voice say, there will be 2 Visa gift cards waiting for you, go to Circuit City and wait for me there, and then you have a commercial for Circuit City playing in the background, that's just sloppy. It just doesn't work.
Well, I know I didn't give this a D, I gave it a C. I gave it a C because this is what my friend Josh says, a TNT classic. So if you're up late, you're watching TNT, you know, and you're bored, you know, you can flip this on and, you know, you can waste some time. But, you
well,
know, it's not a
that's
quality
That's what
film.
TiVos are for. But
true. Good point.
Move on to a movie that I saw today, actually, Frozen River.
I might buy that.
It's not for sale.
He's a smuggler. He'll pay more than it's worth.
I'm not driving just anybody across the border. It's a crime.
There's no border here. This is free trade between nations.
About the border patrol.
They're not going to stop you. You're white.
This is about the woman that was with you. She's known to have brought illegal aliens into the country.
You can't come up with a cash. You have lost your $1,500 deposit.
Frozen River, written and directed by Courtney Hunt. It was a huge splash at Sundance this year. It won the Grand Jury Prize for Drama. And I really don't know why. Was Sundance really that bad? I mean, the movie wasn't awful. The lead actress did a decent job, but everybody else just it was just atrocious acting all the way around, except for the lead. I mean, it's about this woman who lives in northern New York, and she gets involved in this smuggling scheme to bring people from Canada into the United States, and, you know, that weighs on her moral conscience. And then you have this whole subplot about what it's like to be poor in America, like every other indie movie in the history of the world thinks it has to be about. And I thought it had, you know, all these indie cliches in it, and the plot, I did enjoy how the basic plot worked and the basic themes of it. I just think that maybe with a little bit more money, maybe with a little bit more experience, and maybe with much greater talent in the acting area, this would have been a far better movie. And it was pretty boring. The biggest problem I had with it, and with a lot of these movies that come out of Sundance, is that these first-time directors or new directors think that if they have people stare off in the distance and think for a minute, that it somehow means it's a deep movie. Having a slow pace doesn't mean you're a deep movie.
Yeah, I don't really have much to say, Adam. Didn't catch this one. I was expecting good things from this and wanting to see it, but you kind of turned this into a downer for me. I don't think I'm going to check it out now.
Yeah, I usually like these sorts of movies, especially with the whole political theme. I always go for those, but this one, it just didn't do it for me.
All right.
Movie that did it for Aaron, but I think we'll have a little bit of a fight
Next
about.
Next up, The Miracle of St. Anna.
Okay, you and me, you gotta get to that tree. Okay?
Uh-huh.
All right. Go.
Go. All right, The Miracle at St. Anna is the latest Spike Lee movie. And this movie is a picture about the Buffalo Soldier Unit during World War II in Italy. And you've probably seen the preview, and if not, if you do, it's no spoiler. The beginning of the movie starts off with a guy shooting another guy at the post office, and then it kind of tells this backstory about why he did this and this mysterious statue head. And that's what this movie is about. It's got almost a mystical quality at times, because you feel like the statue has this importance, and these soldiers, specifically a few of them, place special importance on this statue. And it's about but this movie is beyond just a World War II movie. It's also about a relationship movie between a soldier and an Italian boy who they can't communicate, but they communicate beyond just speaking, through sign language and just through a bond, a common bond that they have together. And I really thought this movie was heartwarming and heartfelt, and I really didn't think that this movie strayed too far away. Now, some problems I did have with this is that I think it could have used some editing.
Yeah,
it ran a little long. And I really feel like Spike Lee falls in love with himself sometimes, and he doesn't want to give up
certain things.
He's very indulgent, and that I think is his biggest problem. He doesn't like to edit things that he feels like needs to be in there. But I gotta say, Adam, I really liked how this movie unfolded, and I love this movie. I didn't expect to, and I loved it.
Well, a little bit of backstory behind this: when Clint Eastwood made Flags of Our Fathers and Letters to Iwo Jima, Spike Lee, publicly, he got very upset about it, and he talked about how Clint Eastwood didn't include any non-white soldiers in his movies, which representing the American side, and they had a very public argument about that. And so Spike Lee decided to make his own World War II movie, and the movie ended up being, at least in my opinion, very emblematic of Spike Lee's career. It starts out maybe the first half hour I really loved. It takes on, no holds barred, very tough look at American racism and how that plays out. And then the movie kind of gets distracted and forgets all about the racism it brought up early on and ends up being just a standard level movie full of war cliches.
I disagree on the racism. They bring that back up. They show you that flashback scene
to
Louisiana.
Like,
they talk about how comfortable they feel in Italy.
It's not interwoven throughout the story,
it's
though.
There. I think it's there. I think it's just there's too many scenes where it strays from that and it doesn't quite fill in the gaps at times.
And I mean, apart from the whole racial issue, I also thought he did a disservice by making all of the black characters in this movie stereotypes that would have been laughed out of a 1920s movie. I thought it had a lot of problems, obviously, with the pacing and the editing, like we talked about. There were some parts that I like the little boy's relationship with one of the soldiers, but it ended up being just a mishmash of all these different elements. I didn't really know where it was going. The ending didn't really tie into anything else that we saw throughout the movie. They just lug around the statue head. Every 15 minutes, they make an obligatory reference to it. I didn't think that the statue head had anything to do with the movie at all, other than it was a prop.
I gotta be like Obama here. Excuse me, Adam. I need to correct something here.
You just don't understand.
I gotta say, I think the statue was a key part of the movie, and I think it's obvious throughout the movie. At the beginning, they try to reference the statue as being, I'm invisible in this movie. This is.
And when does the invisibility come into play?
Well, the statue is what ties everything together.
I won't spoil it, but the invisibility doesn't work.
It ties everything together, and why it's so important to him is the statue and everything.
All right, and then the other problem I have is this is something I'm sick of in these World War II movies. All the mean Germans talk in this really gruff voice, and all the nice ones read poetry and look at sunsets. I'm like, give me a break.
Well,
come
that's
on.
In every movie. You can't just blame this movie on that because it happens to everybody. When it comes to the stereotypes, I mean, if you have white characters in, like, Saving Private Ryan, there were stereotypes in that movie. So there's always going to be stereotypes.
But when you make a movie
especially in war movies.
When you make a movie specifically to combat racism and that he's seen in other World War II movies.
Who says he's just doing this as a political act?
He, not just as a political act, but that was, we all know that this came out of his argument with Clint Eastwood.
The film was already filmed when that argument happened. He'd already finished the film, so.
If it's Spike Lee and he's talking about race, I expect him to have something much more intelligent to say than what this movie
did. I think you're trying to put too much into this and trying to put too much political spin on this. This was just a good war movie. I mean, this...
It was a passable war movie.
This movie, I would say, was a little bit drawn out, but it's similar to Saving Private Ryan and what it was trying to accomplish. Was it drawn out too much? Could it use an editor? Yes. Saving Private Ryan was more concise, but it had some great battle scenes and it had some great heartfelt scenes. I don't know what the deal is. People love war movies. We love We Were Soldiers and stuff. This is right up there. I love this movie.
I guess this will just have to be something we agree to disagree about.
Or I am a Spike Lee apologist, though, so I got to add that in there.
And a movie that I suppose we feel obligated to at least talk about is Nights at Rodentha.
Tuesday? Dinner is 7:30 if you defer, because you are
the only guest.
Is something wrong with your table?
Didn't want to eat alone.
Oh, well, you didn't come here for the beach.
No, I came here to talk to somebody.
It must have been very hurtful for you to be held responsible.
Is he good looking?
Don't start with me.
It's Nights at Rodanthe, apparently, but
we got a correction from the booth.
You know, based on a book by Nicholas Sparks, like The Notebook was. I saw about a minute of it. I wanted to throw up.
Disclaimer: we didn't see this movie, so.
I think it's one of those movies where, no matter what we say, the exact same people are going to see it anyway, and those same people are going to love it, no matter how terrible it is.
I don't know about that. This is not getting the reviews by the critics that The Notebook got. So if you're expecting The Notebook, I would think you beware, because this is not getting the same buzz or anything as The Notebook. I like The Notebook, actually. Yeah. And this movie is not getting the same buzz, so I'd beware of this.
There are plenty of good other choices for date movies and sappy movies if you want one. So.
Exactly. So just beware. This isn't getting the greatest buzz. We didn't see it, but we want to help you out.
Right. Well, we are going to move on to a break now, but we have a trivia question for you to think about before
this is a good
we go
one.
On. This one I bet you nobody at home will get without cheating. What rank did Paul Newman hold on Richard Nixon's famous enemy list?
Razorback Reels is made possible by our friends at AMC Fiesta Square, where movies are just $4 every day and night, Monday through Thursday, and $4 before 4 o'clock on the weekends.
This is KXUA 88.3!
Oh, it's such a heartwarming film about two brothers and a boy and his father.
But they really represent sort of the neo-existentialist way of thinking.
Entertainment, fashion, and Hollywood gossip.
Tuesdays at 7 on UATV.
And the answer to our question is 19. If you missed the question, it was, what rank did Paul Newman hold on Richard Nixon's infamous enemy list? And apparently he was only the 19th biggest enemy to America.
Well, he
at the
had
time.
20 on the list, right?
Right, 20 on this list. So, is that a compliment or not?
Yeah, I don't know. That's curious.
Right. But apparently it was because he was doing all these commercials for Democrats. So that's why he made the list.
Paul Newman is a legend in acting as well as a philanthropist. And racing, car racing as well.
Right.
And we're going to do a tribute of some of his greatest, best well-known films, right. I guess.
A very small selection.
Yeah, there's a lot that we didn't include, but these are some of the best, at least.
Probably his biggest breakout role was Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, where he played opposite Elizabeth Taylor. And, here he is here. It's based on a Tennessee Williams play, which I read the synopsis of on Wikipedia.
Yeah.
So that makes me completely informed.
I've seen this movie, and it's a good movie. A lot of times I get this mixed up with another one of his, Sweet Bitter of Youth, which is Tennessee Williams. But both of those movies are actually really good. And it really shows, young Paul Newman and why he was such a heartthrob and why he, was such a, people thought he was going to be the next Marlon Brando, right along that scene at this point. This is the early 60s. And this is a really good movie. That kind of shows his Southern charm in this movie. And he did a lot of movies around this time that kind of appealed to the South. He did Hud at this time, and this is a good example of that. And he's a really good young kind of like rebel role in this. I really like that movie.
Right, that's the role that he really played throughout his whole career, is being sort of the outsider, the, I guess, misunderstood rebel, but he doesn't really want to be understood.
Yeah,
so
it is. It's like a confused, it's exactly. Very much Brando-ish, I could say. You can see where he got a lot of Brando influence.
Exactly. And I followed this up a few years later with The Hustler. This is, one of my favorite sports movies, at least, and it's where he plays a pool shark. I'm sure we all
Fast
know
Eddie.
How The Hustle works. And,
yeah.
And he plays opposite Minnesota Fats.
Which is Jackie Gleason, and he's also great in that movie as well. And this movie is really gives you that underground world of pool and how the hustle and everything. And it ended up, the sequel to this was later in his career. But, this one, he was really good. And he also played that sharp young, sabutant in this. And he was really good.
It ends up being, I really loved his performance in this. I think this, other than, Butch Cassidy, this is the first Paul Newman movie that I ever saw. I was just really impressed throughout with how, well he interacted. This is a very complex story and a very complex character. Homeless, poor, and broke. And he didn't end up turning that into the stereotype he could have with the role.
Yeah, and the movie doesn't end in, I think, the stereotype at the time.
And then the movie, just a few years later, is one of our favorites, Cool Hand Luke.
This is probably the movie he's probably most well known for, and deservingly so. It's a great movie, and he plays a great character in this.
Like, we've got a failure to communicate.
Yeah, everybody's heard that line. See, Black, we got a failure to communicate. And it's got the famous egg-eating scene in this. If you haven't seen this movie, you need to, because this is not only a great movie, it's a part of pop culture, and entertainment. So, I think most people probably are somewhat aware of this, if any of the
roles. Even if they don't know that they're aware of it.
Yeah, even if they don't know, they've heard of this somehow, but... Yeah, Cool Hand Luke is a classic. What else can you say about this? It's a great movie.
And he got another Best Actor nomination for this. He had quite a throughout his career, but he didn't win until later on.
Yeah.
And then Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
Another iconic role for him.
My dad's favorite movie of all time, so I always loved watching this. And this is one of my favorite scenes in the whole movie, too. He's like, I only agreed to challenge because I thought nobody would actually do it. This is the classic anti-hero version of a Western.
And I think this is his first role that he teamed up with Robert Redford in, and they went on to do a couple other movies as well that they were really great together in. And it's a great buddy movie. This is a quintessential buddy movie about these two guys, conflicted outlaws and heroes. And it's another.
And
it's another
classic
movie.
Catherine Ross.
Yeah, you gotta see this movie. Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head. Everybody's heard that song. This is where the movies come from. That's where it came from. The song. So.
I mean, if you like, even if you don't really like Westerns, this is one you definitely have to see.
Yeah, there's more to this than just like the shoot 'em up Western. There's a lot more to this going on.
And next we had The Sting.
They're back together, Newman and
Best Academy Award for Best Picture, this one. That surprised me a little bit, but this is a very fun movie. It's hard to talk about. The clip I had was the very ending, and I'm not going to give that away for anybody.
It's a big con movie. We can say that. It's all about this big con that's going on, and there's a lot of stuff going on about gambling and stuff. So I think that's fair to say.
After you see this, you will want to become a con artist.
Yeah, it's hard to really talk about this without giving away things in this. But this has really got intricate stuff going on in this, and it's a really good story. I really like this movie.
Fantastic score, Scott Joplin.
Yeah, it is. And yeah, it's. I mean, Paul Newman is excellent, but so they're both excellent in this, Redford and Newman, and I think that's where they kind of work off each other, and that's how they succeeded so well.
And that they helped out with the Hole in the Wall Gang charity that both of them continue to contribute to throughout their careers. And you know, Paul Newman did a lot of philanthropy. We have our Newman's Own Italian dressing, and you know, he did a lot of work with that. Whenever you buy something for Newman's Own, it goes to his
all profits.
Yeah, to his non-profit or one of those IRS things. Yeah. And it ends up getting to a whole bunch of good charities, especially to help out with children. Maybe that's what Richard Nixon didn't like.
Yeah, we don't know. We'll see. We don't know. He is the villain in history.
Yeah, we'll find. But we had The Color of Money. He ended up doing quite a bit later with Tom Cruise.
Which was the kind of sequel to The Hustler.
Sequel / remake of The Hustler, maybe. And we have Forrest Whitaker with him right now. Very early.
Yeah, I didn't realize that until I saw this clip. But yeah, I hadn't seen this in a long time. But yeah, Fast Eddie becomes Minnesota Fats, basically, in this. And Tom Cruise takes over the Fast Eddie role. And
Cruise this, right there,
this was also, was this one Best Picture in this?
Didn't get Best
Picture. No, but it was nominated, and he won for Best Actor.
Did get him his only Best Actor win that he had. And this, I haven't seen this movie. I've seen parts of it.
Yeah, it's. I mean, if you like The Hustler, I think you'll like this movie. I don't think Tom Cruise pulls off the Paul Newman spot, and that may be
I don't think anybody could pull off.
Yeah, especially at that point in Tom Cruise's career, where he was more of a heartthrob, rather than. I mean, I think Tom Cruise has done some good acting, but this is maybe not his best stuff. This is his early on stuff. But I don't think this is Paul Newman's best role. I mean, he won Best Actor for this. I think he's done better stuff. But it's more like
it was a legacy
tribute.
Win.
Yeah,
yeah, it's
like a tribute.
Wait, he hasn't won yet. It's like Scorsese with
The Departed.
Departed. Yeah, didn't really deserve it, but hey, he hadn't won one.
And so. I kind of like Jackie Gleason more in the Minnesota Fats role than Paul Newman in this. But it's still a really good movie. And it's.
But we're complaining about it because that's what we do.
Yeah, that's what we do. But it's great. Yeah.
And then finished off his career with the one that probably most people now would recognize him, thanks to all these young kids
these
who don't watch classic movies.
Yeah, and that's Cars, the Pixar animation movie.
And he plays Doc Hudson in this.
Yeah.
Teaches Lightning McQueen all the tricks and the trade.
Yeah, he kind of plays what you would expect maybe of Paul Newman at this point. This is just a few years ago, two years ago. So this is his last film. I guess this is his last film officially.
He might have been in some small role or something, but I can't remember if he did. And I guess it's sort of a nice tribute, just a way to round him out. He plays the older mentor and rides off into the sunset at the end.
And Paul Newman was heavily involved in auto racing, so you know this was something close to him and dear to him. And Cars is a fun movie, but you know what you're getting with this. But we did, there was failure to communicate all the movies.
We needed to do.
I mean, The Verdict was a great one.
The Towering Inferno.
Yeah, Exodus. Nobody's Fool. He was nominated
Exodus
for Best
way
Actor.
Way before he did anything else.
Yeah, so there's been many classics. Fort Apache, The Bronx, I can name them forever. Right. But Paul Newman was a great legendary actor, and he's going to be well missed in Hollywood.
Check him out on Netflix. Go to the library. It won't be hard at all to find something to watch. Give him a nice tribute.
So rest in peace, Paul Newman. Right.
Well, we're going to wrap up for this week, but thank you so much for staying with us. And be sure to visit our friends at AMC Fiesta Square. Every Monday through Thursday, day and night, you have $4 movies.
It's a great deal.
All right, fantastic weekday date. And then on weekends before 4 o'clock, then it's $4 as well.
And they always have the best indie movies. They always get the most obscure indie movies, like
so
Frozen River.
You get Frozen River. I mean, maybe that one wasn't great, but they're going to get some more next week.
Yeah.
And we'll let you know which ones are good and which ones aren't.
Yeah, and there's a whole slew of good movies coming out next week, so be ready
to Beverly Hills
that.
Chihuahua.
Yeah,
I'm really
that's
excited for that. Now we have an American Carol. We have Nick and Nora's Playlist.
Flash of Genius.
Right, Flash of Genius. We could go on and on about
next
week's show.
There's a ton of movies, make sure you tune in next week to check that out.
8 o'clock every Monday night on UATV Channel 14 or at RazorbackReels.com.
Yeah, if you missed the show, just check us out at the web and we'll be on there to entertain you and inform you. So.
Well, we'll see y'all again next week.
I'm Adam Roberts.